This is the motherboard of a Steam Deck, the electronic heart of Valve's handheld gaming console. It contains all the essential parts, such as M.2 and SD card slots, Wi-Fi, unified memory, and above all, the APU. This specific board is from a first generation LCD Steam Deck, which means we are looking at the 7nm version of AMD's custom VanGo APU. But we are not here to discuss the motherboard and its components. There are already plenty of teardown videos out there. No, we will go on a journey deep into the silicon itself. We've never seen before ultra high resolution die shots that allow us to analyze the entire chip in extreme detail. And without spoiling anything, there's a major surprise waiting to be discovered. None of this would have been possible without the amazing work of Fritzchen Fritz, who used his magic to produce the amazing die shots you're about to see for the first time. I highly recommend you check out his other work too. He's truly a master of his craft. I've linked his silicon photography and social media pages below. With that, let's begin our deep dive into the silicon heart of Valve's Steam Deck. Being confronted with a new chip for the first time can be a bit overwhelming. And the extreme resolution of this die shot doesn't really help. If anything, it adds another layer of complexity. Remember, this is not a design abstraction. These are real pictures. Let's take a quick look at the official specs before we start to remind us what we are searching for in the Silicon Metropolis. The LCD Steam Deck is powered by a custom AMD APU, codenamed VanGo or Aerith, depending on if you ask AMD or Valve. It contains a 4-core, 8-thread Zen 2 CPU, a RDNA 2-based iGPU with 8 compute units, a quad-channel 128-bit low-power DDR5 memory interface, and of course all the other bells and whistles like video and display engines, PCI Express, USB, display ports, and other I.O. Starting at the very top, we can spot 4 symmetrical blocks located in close proximity to the edge of the chip. The high resolution of the die shot allows us to take a really detailed look at their composition. What we are looking at is the physical layer of the low-power DDR5 memory interface. Each block handles 32 bits for a combined 128-bit quad-channel memory interface. They are used to connect to the 4 memory modules located right next to the chip on the motherboard. Right below the physical layer, we can find the memory controller. It sits in close proximity to all 4 parts of the interface and manages the flow of the data through the interface itself. Memory interface and controllers work hand-in-hand to communicate with the unified system memory. It's hard to determine the exact size of the controller. It could be a bit larger than I've marked here, but I'm pretty confident. Something I'm less confident about is the VCN or Video Core Next, located to the right of the memory controller. VCN is AMD's video engine and handles the and encoding of video codecs, including AV1. It might include other silicon structures next to it, but I can't say for sure. Let me know if you can offer more information about the exact location and size of the VCN on this die shot. Let's tackle the CPU next. We know it's a quad-core Zen 2 design, which means we are looking for 4 symmetrical blocks next to a large cache. It's not as easy as expected on this die shot, as there are plenty of areas with symmetrical blocks and cache. But with some basic knowledge about how AMD's CPU cores look like, we can find the right spot. The CPU is located on the left side of the chip, right below the memory interface. It's a single Zen 2 core complex with 4 MB of shared L3 cache in the middle and 2 cores above and below. A very symmetrical layout, but we can go deeper, much deeper. The resolution is high enough to make out the individual cache blocks. There are 8 visible SRAM blocks with 512 kilobytes each for a combined 4 megabytes of shared L3 cache. We don't have to just trust the specs, we can literally see and count them with our own eyes. Even the tiny L3 cache tags are visible, which map the data stored in the cache blocks to the data stored on the system memory. It's like a small inventory list for data. Right next to the L3 cache, the individual Zen 2 CPU core starts. The first part of each core is the private L2 cache, with 2 256 kilobyte blocks and related tags. The L2 cache has an even lower latency than the L3 cache. Next to the L2 cache, we can also find the area that manages the current privilege level, or CPL. The current privilege level is used by the system to control access to resources and the execution of specific instructions. There are 4 levels ranging from 0, which is the most privileged, to 3, which is least privileged. The kernel, for example, runs on level 0, and normal applications run on level 3. The next area of the CPU core, the integer unit, might look a bit all over the place at first, but even here we can identify the individual parts. It's super interesting how much area of a modern CPU core is actually used for cache. We started with the L3, then the private L2, and now inside the core itself, there's even more cache. Top left, we have the data cache, bottom right, the instruction cache, and as you can see, load store unit, branch prediction, and the decoder also have visible cache cells, though much smaller in size. We are only talking a few kilobytes here. The arithmetic logic unit, or LLU for short, is actually really tiny in comparison to the other areas of the integer unit. That's where math operations like addition, subtraction, multiplication, divisions, and so on are performed. Last but certainly not least, the floating point unit sits above the integer unit with scheduler, registers, and the FP math areas where the actual floating point math is calculated. The microcode is stored to the right of the FPU. That's the whole layout of a Zen 2 core. One area for L2 cache and CPL, one for integer math, and one for floating point math. It's insane how highly detailed the die charts from Fritzchen's Fritz are. We are literally looking inside a Zen 2 core, and it's interesting to see how much area each part of the core is taking up. L2 cache and floating point unit have a similar size, while the integer unit takes up the majority of the core area. I've measured the total core area at 2.82388 square millimeters, very close to the 2.83 square millimeters AMD claims for a Zen 2 core. If we zoom out, it becomes apparent that even though the CPU is one of the most important parts of an APU, it takes up a rather small amount of the total die size, only about 20.18 square millimeters or 12.4% of the silicon area. With the CPU located, the GPU is next. There's supposed to be 8 RDNA 2 compute units with up to 1.6 FP32 teraflops on Vango. Lucky for us, we don't have to look far since the compute units are right below the CPU. With our bare eyes, we can make out 4 symmetrical clusters. But aren't there supposed to be 8? This is due to the architectural layout of RDNA 2, which always groups 2 compute units into a so-called work group. The 4 visible clusters are work groups, and each of them contains 2 compute units. This is a smart approach, since some areas are shared between both compute units in a single workgroup, saving precious silicon area. Let's have a look at how a workgroup is structured. Starting from the bottom, there are 2 separate arithmetic logic units, or ALUs, with 32 shaders each. These ALUs are much smaller and less complex than the ALU found within the integer core of the CPU, but there are a lot more of them. Right above the ALUs, we can locate the instruction cache and the scalar unit, which is shared between both compute units. Next are 2 more separate ALU clusters for each compute unit. In total, a single compute unit has 64 ALUs, 2x32, and a workgroup has 128. As Vango has 4 compute units, the total comes to 512 ALUs or shaders. To calculate the theoretical FP32 performance, we multiply the number of ALUs by the maximum clock speed of 1.6 GHz, and then multiply it by 2 since each ALU can handle 2 instructions. The result is 1.6 teraflops. Now you know. Above the second ALU cluster, we have the individual L0 cache and a larger 128 KB local data share. The final part of the workgroup is for texture mapping units, TMUs, and AMD's hardware ray tracing acceleration. Yes, the Steam Deck supports hardware ray tracing, although not with a lot of punch. Zooming out once again, the compute units, similar to the CPU cores, don't really take up a lot of space. I measured about 4.42 square millimeters for a single workgroup, and 17.68 square millimeters for all 4 of them. That's only 10.9% of the die area. The CPU complex and the GPU compute units combined only take up 23.3% of the chip. What's going on? Well, for one, the GPU is much more than just its compute units. The GPU MISC area is rather large and houses things like render backends, cache, controllers, and much more. I'm actually not 100% sure about the total area of the GPU. It might go all the way to the memory controllers. If we look back at the initial specs with 4 Zen 2 CPU cores, 8 RDNA 2 compute units, and a 128-bit memory interface, we now have located and labeled all of the most important areas. But almost half of the chip is still unmarked. Something weird is going on. There's something on this chip that we didn't expect, and that isn't part of any other AMD APU. We'll get to that in just a second, but first let's take a shot at all the I.O. we can find. Almost all I.O. is located on the right side of the chip, with a lot of SerDes or serial to deserial controllers. It's easy to mark a I.O. block, but difficult to determine its exact function. I'm pretty certain about the location of the PCI Express 3.0 lanes. There's 12 in total, with 2 4X blocks and 2 2X blocks. The 2X blocks can also be used for SATA functionality. Zooming in, it looks like modern art. And I'd be lying if I said I know what we are looking at. Maybe a PCI engineer can give some insights on all the structures found within each PCI Express lane. Below the PCI Express lanes, we can locate a lot of USB ports. I count 8 USB 2.0 ports and what I think is used for high-speed USB 3.2. There has to be a display output. I would locate it above the PCI Express lanes, though I'm not really sure. I'm hoping for additional input. If you have something to add, please leave a comment down below. There's so much knowledge out there, I'm always looking to increase mine. This is the first time a die shot of Van Gogh is released and I'm certainly not capable to label every single part on the chip by myself. I need your help. Something that's really interesting is that we can see what's outside of the chip as well. When chips are produced on a silicon wafer, they aren't placed right next to each other. Even though it often looks like it, there's always a small gap between each chip, called the script line. That's how the chips can be cut out of the wafer without damaging the die itself. These script lines are not empty, they often contain transistors for different purposes. And part of the script line is clearly visible right on the outer bounds of the chip. Not every transistor on this die shot is actually part of the chip itself. I've measured the chip at 13.31 × 12.19 mm, which gives us a die size of 162.25 square mm. But that's with a tiny bit of scribe lines on each side. The real die size thus is a bit smaller. But enough about I/O and everything else at the edge of the chip. Let's discuss the elephant in the room, the surprise I've been mentioning. And let me tell you, it's a pretty big one. There's a large area on this chip that I had problems identifying at first. Maybe you've already noticed it. Some of its structures look like cores of some kind, and you can definitely see cache blocks too. At first glance, I even thought I was looking at the Zen 2 CPU complex, but quickly realized that this area doesn't look like anything else AMD has previously designed. The unknown area is about 22.2 square millimeters in size, which is 13.7% of the entire chip, more than the CPU complex or all 8 GPU compute units. This area has a very special function that isn't related to the Steam Deck, because there's one other product that is powered by the AMD's Van Gogh APU, the Magic Leap 2 AR glasses. The chip that is powering the Magic Leap 2 includes a quad-core Zen 2 CPU in 7 nanometers and a RDNA 2 based GPU. Which chip could that be? Even the amount of cache fits perfectly, though both CPU and GPU are clocked lower than they are in the Steam Deck. There's no doubt Magic Leap 2 runs on AMD's Van Gogh, with Marrow as a new codename. And Magic Leap mentions something else, something that is not part of the official Steam Deck specs. A 14-core Computer Vision Processing Engine, or CVIP for short. That's our previously unidentified area. Now that we know what to look for, let's see if we can find all 14 cores. There are 6 clearly visible cores in the center, marked in yellow. 2 more cores are below the yellow ones. I've marked them in red. They are of a different core type. Another 6 core, but much smaller ones, are in the top right of the CVIP area, marked in pink. It's not 14 of the same cores. It's a 6+6+2 design, almost like Intel's or ARM's PNE cores, only with small, large, and even larger cores. The narrow rectangle in the middle connecting the cores might be a ring bus. As you can see, there are other areas too, but I'm unable to label them. After a bit of research, I'm pretty certain these cores are designs from Cadence, probably part of their Fusion and Vision DSP line. Each core size should also be a different core type, with focus on image processing and machine learning. These are the primary driver behind the abilities of the Magic Leap 2. But since it does share the same APU with the Steam Deck, these cores are also included in the chips used for the Steam Deck, at least on the Steam Deck LCD with the 7nm variant of Van Gogh. This has a couple of implications. First, if the CVIP area isn't manually disabled, for example with a laser cut, it might be possible to enable it with a firmware or BIOS modding on a Steam Deck. Sadly, I don't own one, mine had to die so we could get these amazing die shots. But even if I had one, I wouldn't know how to figure out if a part of the chip is hidden with firmware or BIOS modifications. If you know someone who plays around with the Steam Deck BIOS, let them know. It would be cool if there's a way to enable or access these CVIP cores, even though I think it's likely they are hard disabled. If we could access them, the Steam Deck could turn into a little AI accelerator. The second implication has to do with the size of the new 6nm APU inside the Steam Deck OLED. When Valve announced the refresh also included a 6nm APU, I wasn't really surprised. TSMC's N6 node is part of the same 7nm process family as the previously used N7 node. They share the same design rules, and with the introduction of EUV layers, N6 not only offers a higher yield, but most likely is also cheaper to produce in general, on top of small improvements in the areas of performance, efficiency, and transistor density. a obvious choice for a refresh, but first pictures revealed that the 6nm APU inside the Steam Deck OLED is quite a bit smaller than the 7nm version. The size difference is larger than I had expected and can really be explained by a simple shrink from N7 to N6. The 6nm APU, codenamed Sephiroth by Valve, has a die size of about 131 square millimeters, a 20% error reduction compared to the 163 square millimeters of the 7nm Mango. If we simply go by TSMC specs, it doesn't seem that unlikely, as N6 is supposed to offer up to 18% higher logic density than N7. But you have to consider that this only applies to logic transistors and not cache and analog designs like all the I/O areas. And as we have just seen, cache and I/O are a major part of the chip. Even if all the logic transistors would perfectly scale with a 18% area reduction, a simple 6nm shrink would be far off a 20% total area reduction. The decrease in die size must be related to something else. I'm very confident that the 6nm APU inside the Steam Deck OLED is a redesign of the 7nm APU that removes the CVIP cores. And it does make sense from Valve's perspective. When the original Steam Deck launched, it was pretty much a gamble. Aside from Nintendo, gaming handhelds weren't really a thing. Products like the Nvidia Shield, for example, are extremely niche products. Valve couldn't anticipate the demand, and that's why they shared the design with Magic Leap. It was a perfect fit since both devices are ultra-low power. Valve could optimize CPU and GPU for low TDP ranges, and Magic Leap included their CVIP cores. Design costs and risk were split. But the Steam Deck was a huge success. It sold out for months, and now there's a growing handheld market with strong competition. Valve knows they will sell many more Steam Decks in the future. Creating a 6nm version without the added weight of Magic Leap CVIP cores became an economically viable choice, and Valve took it. I hope you enjoyed this chip deep dive as much as I did. It was a long road from the first idea to this video, and I couldn't have done it without Fritzchen's Fritz. And the best part is that we actually learned something new. As far as I know, it's not only the first die shot of Mango, but also the first time we see what Magic Leap's CVIP cores look like. There's a lot to unwrap here, and I'm hopeful others will also take a look at the die shots and increase our understanding of Mango as a chip. Mango is a tightly packed and highly customized APU. It's astonishing how much power it can deliver at such low TDPs, especially when almost 14% of its chip area are transistors that are not used by the Steam Deck. And you already know that at some point I have to take a look inside the new 6nm Steam Deck OLED APU to hopefully confirm my assumptions that it's more than just a simple process node shrink. If you know anyone who has a broken Steam Deck OLED, let me know. Maybe Fritzchen's Fritz is up for another die shot session, fingers crossed. A special thanks to all my current Patreons. You might not be many, but I appreciate every single one of you. Your very own dollars allowed me to buy a Steam Deck for the sake of science. I hope you enjoyed this video and see you in the next one.